I think I was a great disappointment with that, with Sue Lawley, because she was doing it when I was doing it. And I think I asked for, I suppose I was influenced by having been in the army, I asked for a camp bed officers for the use of, which is what you have in the army. And I thought that rather than lie on the ground, this camp bed, and I think I asked also for a mosquito net, because that came with the camp bed, or you could have it added. And I thought, if I was on this desert island, that would do. But I think that was really influence for national service. I wouldn't have thought of it if I hadn't been a national serviceman. Otherwise, I can't remember much about the program. What you have to do, I think, if you do it, is you have to pace yourself. You have to say, take bits of music that correspond with the periods of your life. And I think I managed to do that. Otherwise, I'm not terribly musical, so I wasn't an ideal choice. And I had things, you know, all the hackneyed things like. I don't know, the opera was a drinking song from whatever it is. I can't even remember what opera it is. But my wife was some help with it. She's much more musical than I am. But it was pretty... And I had a lot of speech, including a Nye Bevan speech, which I was delighted to put in. And they thought it was too short, but they let me have it. And I think I had always had that other American... when you're old and grey, dear, dear, what is his name? Plays the piano and twiddles, but that was almost speech. It wasn't high classical music much, no. And it had things even like Vivat Vagina, because I had been at Westminster School, and that being the sort of coronation thing was sung, shouted out by the Queen's Scholars. So we had all sorts of odd things. I enjoyed doing it, they're quite fun. I was quite old by the time I did it. I think I was... I'd certainly left the Times by the time I did it, I think. Not given up the column, but I'd left the Times full time, because I did spend, you know, I spent 6 years in the Elysian Fields, rowing people across the Styx to their sort of obituary notices. Odd job that, but a job I quite enjoyed. Very much the hinge of journalism and history, being an obits editor, and admittedly it's an old man's job, because if you're old, can you sort of remember enough about the people who died. But it was very much away from the mainstream of journalism, but and I did it, I think, between 1993 and 1999, that's right. Small staff, sort of three or four people, all sort of each day putting out the slab and laying out people on it. I didn't find it unrewarding. Obits had a great vogue at one time. They suddenly became very fashionable. I think they've gone off a bit now, but for a period mainly because of The Independent, I think, and because The Telegraph under Montgomery Massingbird did sort of produce a new kind of art form, basically. He's dead now, poor chap. I think we were fighting back against The Telegraph. That's one reason why I was hired to do it, because the Times realised that they were being left standing by these new witty, funny notices that appeared in the Daily Telegraph, which used not to do obits at all. And it's quite a feat to get them up to the standard they did, really only starting them in 1986, I think, whereas the Times done them for, well, not as long as people think. I think the Times regular obits paid started about 1920. But it hasn't even been going 100 years yet. But they did occasional pieces before, but that was sort of Death of the Duke of Wellington, all that kind of thing, you know, the one-day specials.